So, on behalf of Harinam Desh, we welcome you all once again for this Saturday feast program.
Hari Bol.
So, the first day, kind English. As we are in English game board here, so eins, zwei, drei. Okay, then we have, so everyone understands English, right? So hopefully, yes. So the class will be in English, so the German translation will be in that corner.
Yeah.
So first of all, I would like to really thank you for this opportunity to speak here. And I wish to seek blessings from Her Grace Dinshan Mataji. So her presence here in Krishna Consciousness is cumulative more than my age, total age. So Mataji, please bless me so that I can speak some nice words what I have learned from Prabhupada and my Gurudev. So
herewith I am asking Krishna to give you all inspiration you need to speak. You are sitting on the Vyasa. Vyasa Deva seat. He is giving you all blessings. So I can only ask him to inspire you. Thank you for coming, for taking the trouble.
Thank you. So with the blessings of Vaishnavas, and only by the blessing of Vaishnavas, so only by the blessing of the devotees one can achieve anything in the life. So this says from the Shastras. So today we have a very special topic. So you can see the Bhadra Purnima everywhere. And Mataji already gave a very nice explanation, like whoever donates the Bhagavatam, keeping on the throne, golden throne, and donate on the Bhadra Purnima day, which was on 2nd of September, directly, without doing anything, they will go back to Godhead. They will go to the Vaikuntha. Just doing one single act in our life. So that means this is nothing less than a great miracle, a great opportunity. Simply some people miss, or many of us miss. Except 15 people have used this opportunity to go back to Godhead, and rest of us, we miss the bus. So nevertheless, Prabhupada, who is our founder Acharya, has made this family so nice that in Hohenstein, in Arstrasse, in Germany, we are able to gather here and speak about Krishna. So we don't need any bigger miracle than this. We might have seen from the Indian perspective, Swami is doing something miracles, but is this not a miracle? That in Germany, among the mountains, we are sitting here and speaking about the Bhadra Purnima, and which is like really like something great. I mean, just by donating, you are going back to Godhead. Do nothing, just nothing.
I've been serving this movement for 50 years. If I would have known that so much work, 50 years for one Bhagavatam, I would have.
So, okay. Let me speak from my heart. I mean, I don't want to get into the system. So, yeah. So, Bhagavatam. So, how many of you know Bhagavatam? Bhagavad Gita, you might have heard. But how many of you know Bhagavatam? Because, Mataji asked, some people are new here. So, just I would like to know. So, everyone knew. Who doesn't know Bhagavatam?
You know, nobody is
going to
say, I don't know.
Okay. So, anybody... Whether we know or no, don't know, but we need to know really the glories of Bhagavatam. What is Bhagavatam? So why it is on the throne? So why Lord is not there? Why Bhagavatam is there? Yeah, let's keep it more interactive so that it becomes more lively. Yes, bro.
Supreme knowledge.
Supreme knowledge. Okay, supreme knowledge. Anybody else?
Pure knowledge.
Yes. Srimad Bhagavatam is supreme knowledge, pure knowledge. Yes.
Supreme God Self.
Supreme God Self, Krishna Self.
Krishna Himself, yeah, very nice. So, in the Bhagavatam, second canto, it is said that when Krishna left this world, He appeared in the form of Bhagavatam.
Bhagavatam
on the Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam ki.
Yeah.
So that's why this Srimad Bhagavatam is on the throne. So this is not a book. This is a person himself. So the Supreme Lord, person himself, has appeared in the form of Bhagavatam. So Sanatana Goswami said, a person who needs a guru, who needs a teacher, who needs a best friend, who needs luck, who needs wealth, who needs all happiness, such a person should read Srimad Bhagavatam. So anybody sitting here who doesn't want happiness, who doesn't want luck, who doesn't want to be wealthy. Wealthy means really spiritual wealth and the real material wealth. Lot of money, gold coins, everything. So who is sitting here who is not willing to do this or who doesn't want to have this? So nobody, right? So the person who is reading this will get all these things. He will get supreme happiness, he will get great luck, he will get wealth, and he will have a guru in the form of this book and a friend. So Sanatana Goswami, one of the acharyas in the Gaudiya Sampradaya, he says, I pray to such book, I pray to such a person. So that is Bhagavatam. So Bhagavatam is nothing but a person. So he also explained, like Bhagavatam is like a person, so the first, and Bhagavatam has 12 cantos. So 12 cantos means 12 kind of topics. So first, 1 and 2 are considered as feet, 3 and 4 considered as two legs, thighs. 5th canto explains about the navel, 6th about the chest, 7th and 8th about the shoulders and hands, and 9th about the neck, and 10th about the face. So that's why it is also explained, like, how to take the darshan of the deities. When we come to the temple, when we go to any temple, anywhere, there is a procedure. So most of the times we come, we pay obeisances there. So most of the people think that why is somebody paying obeisances? Because this is the temple, before we enter, we respect the Vaishnavas, those who are present here. So the supreme Vaishnava here for us is Srila Prabhupada. So first we pay obeisances to everyone, then come and pay obeisances to Prabhupada, the Guru. And then we pay obeisances to the Lord. So why it is like that? Because the person who is giving us the knowledge, he will become more important in the parampara system. So normally it is said that if you want to see the Lord, what do we need? I want to see the Lord. What do I need?
Someone who is able to see the Lord.
Now I want to see the Lord here sitting. So I need two eyes. So can we really see with our eyes? So Shastras explain that in order to see the Lord, it is better to see through the ears. Shravana. Because when we see the Lord, we just see that, okay, it's made of wooden and things, it is like that, he has earrings, but we are so critical that why the earring is little bent. So we see the Lord through our eyes and we cannot really perceive the greatness of the Lord. So that's why Shastras explains that whoever wants to see the Lord, they should try to see the Lord through the ears. See the Lord through ears, not through the eyes. Because our eyes doesn't have that power to see the Lord. So in order to see the Lord through ears, what do we need?
Ears.
Ears. Yeah, I have ears now. How do I see the...
Chant.
Yes, one more thing.
With silent concentration.
Concentration. So, in order to see the Lord through our ears, we need to understand who He is, first of all. So, first, for example, you might have seen outside, there was a mayor photo. Right? So let's take the example of Chancellor Angela Merkel. Right? All of a sudden now she has entered this room. What will be our reaction? She's the Chancellor of this country. So we immediately get up, give respects to her, welcome her, make her sit, explain what is she doing, and we will ask her, what can we do for you? Now a random person comes in. Do we do the same thing? Actually, we are supposed to do it, but do we do the same thing? No. Why? Why we don't? Everybody agreed, right? We don't do that with a normal person. So why we do with a famous person like that? Because we know that he or she is a famous person. So in order to see the same Lord, so I need to know that he is famous. From where will I see that? From any novel? From any magazine? From any place? No, it comes from the Shastri books. So in the Shastras, it is explained exactly so how it is given. So there is a verse which I want to read it to you. So in the verse, Srimad Bhagavatam 10th canto, 21st chapter, 5th verse, it says, Barha padam nata vara vapu karano karana karanam vibradvasa kanaka kapisam vaijantim chamalam randaram venur adhara sudaya purayan gopa vrinde vrindaranyam swapada ramanam pravisat gita kirti. So the translation is, a lord is someone, Krishna, wearing a peacock feather ornament. So we know that whenever we think of Krishna, we always think, oh, he is wearing the peacock feather. It is said that for the deity worship, those who are pujaris, they know that. That if we don't put the feather in the deities, it is an offense. So that's why it is explained here. So wearing a peacock feather ornament upon his head, blue Karnikara flowers, so we don't have that flowers here. On his ears, a yellow garment as brilliant as gold and the Vaijayanti garland, Vaijayanti mala, so that's also one kind of flowers. So Lord Krishna exhibited his transcendental form as the greatest of dancers as he entered the forest of Vrindavan, beautifying it with the marks of his footprints. He filled the holes of his food with the nectar of his lips, and the cowherd boy sang his glories. So when I have this information, who is Krishna? So the description is given. I don't have to go and ask the mayor of Frankfurt. I don't have to go and ask someone on the street, oh, do you know Krishna? How does he look? Because the original, the real information we get from the Shastras. Shastras are like Shastra Chakshu. Whatever Chakshu means, the seeing. So whatever you want to understand here, you read it from Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam. So we don't have to, Prabhupada has made it so simple. If I want to read this, if I have read only the Sanskrit verse, it would have been like, okay, because we don't understand Sanskrit. So that's why it can just go above our head. But by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada, at the age of 69, he left Vrindavan, where everyone thinks that, okay, at the end of the day, just I want to go and settle down in Vrindavan. So the person who understands bhakti is the ultimate, such person has a desire to say that, okay, when I'm old enough, just I will go to some holy dham and then I will stay there. Sorry. So we think that I will go to the holy dham and settle there. At that particular age, Srila Prabhupada left Vrindavan and went to the west without any connections. When we come from India to here, we call some people like, oh, there is someone, can you please come to the airport, can you pick me up, or just look for me something, please help me how to buy the things, where to buy, where is Aldi, where is Netto, and all this. There was nothing for, practically nothing for Prabhupada. And he had just 40 rupees, which was those times only $7. Which was only $7 at that time. So he left the place like Vrindavan and went to the place like West, where even during those times, even the milk was mixed with omega acid fats, which was like fish, something from the fish. So even the milk was not vegetarian. And a person who is pure Vaishnava is going to a place where he doesn't have anything, no support, nothing. He doesn't know anyone, no support from India, neither from America. There he went and he started the Hare Krishna movement, this ISKCON movement, which we have celebrated 50 years recently also. So, such a person who took so much effort and he made this Bhagavatam into English for us. So, when we know this, then automatically we become eternally grateful to Srila Prabhupada. So that is what the connection between you and me and with Prabhupada. Today we are sitting here only because of one person. Only because of only one and only one person. That is Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. So we are eternally indebted and we will be eternally indebted to Srila Prabhupada for bringing this movement to Germany, to this place. So outside you can see a photo also, which was taken in along with Prabhupada 50 years ago or 60 years ago. Mataji can give more details into that. So we have to be really, this is the connection. What we have the connection with Prabhupada is this is the connection. That today we are sitting here only because of one person and that is Srila Prabhupada. So this blessing we should never forget. So Bhagavatam, so hearing is also has certain kind of things. Let's take an example like a bucket. So when this mercy is coming, when the Bhagavatam is coming, and I have a bucket, so let's consider this is a tap. Bhagavatam tap is coming, water is falling. And I am like a bucket, I am keeping inverted. So Bhagavatam mercy is coming, but I am not ready to take that mercy. So I have kept myself inverted, thinking that, but whatever the reason, so I am not attentive. So when the Bhagavatam is reading or hearing, we have to be attentive. So that the mercy flows inside. And this is the second type. So we are hearing, we are directly keeping our bucket under the tap, but that bucket has holes. What does it mean? So that means we are taking the mercy, but we are not applying. So information, there is no transformation. So today, in the internet world, we get lots and lots of information. But if we don't apply that properly in our life, then there won't be any transformation. So then, that information is just like a junk. We call it junk. So, there are so many emails which are coming to the junk mail. So that is also information, but it is going to the junk. Because that is not useful. So similarly, we have to have a bucket which doesn't have holes. So third kind of listeners, are the buckets are there, but that bucket is already dirty. So the dirt, we come and sit here, clean the bucket, and we go out, we make the dirt again. So it's like, example is given like the elephant bath, taking bath. So elephant goes to the pond or river and takes bath very leisurely, very nicely for hours together. And as soon as outside it comes, what does it do? It takes the sand and put it on the body. So exactly that is also what we do. So we try to become a devotee or we try to understand what is Krishna consciousness, how to live my life, how to do the things, what to do, what not to do. But all of a sudden, as soon as we go to the outside the Krishna conscious world, we put the dirt so much inside. So that is the third kind of listeners. And the fourth one is bucket is there, but we have some anarthas, false ego. Oh, I know everything. My grandmother used to tell me all these things. I know from my childhood I used to do this. As soon as we are not grateful in receiving something, then we stop getting that. So we should be open to take any information. So that's why in the Bhagavad Gita it is explained that a disciple or a student should approach to the teacher with a very humble attitude. So once, as soon as we think that I know everything or I know something, then the learning windows will be switched off. Okay, I know something. I know how to pay our businesses, what to do, what not to do. So I don't want to. So this kind of subtle things goes on. So that's why a listener should be always open to understanding and implement those things, whatever we have heard, and be attentive. So these are the four kinds of listeners one should not be, and exactly the opposite is one should be. So the Bhagavatam is Bhagavatam. Bha is bhakti, va is vairagya. Vairagya means the renunciation. Bhakti is bhakti, devotional life. Bhagava. Va is vairagya, ga is jnana, and tvam is tattva. So that is tattva means who is Lord, what is he, what is he does. So if you see any religion, in those religions, what is God? God is a light, God is an energy. So what does the God do? So if I am able to look like this, if I am able to do something, so God should also have something, right? What he should be doing? If he is not doing anything, then it must be a boring thing, right? Just now today I have a nice life here. So I have my house, I have my wife, I have my car, I have my big building, I have my job, and I'm happy. So why do I need to go to a place which is like void, is nothing? There is no family, there is no food, it is just all energy. So it must be boring, right? So that's why it is in the Bhagavatam it is explained the tattva gyan. So tattva gyan is like who is Lord, what does he do, when does he get up, what does he wear. So if you have seen that from the last verse, so he's wearing the yellow garments, like golden garments. He's having a peacock feather. His lips are like bimba fruit, like pinkish red. So every description is given. How does the Lord look like? So that's why it becomes more imperative for us to learn what is in the Bhagavatam or in the Shastras. So this is about Bhagavatam. So Bhagavatam is... deities are in the temple and Bhagavatam is a mobile temple. So as we have said already, the Bhagavatam is nothing but a person who is a deity form. So that means this deity form can be taken anywhere, in our car, to office, to our kitchen. So wherever you are comfortable, the deity is coming with you. So that is the advantage with the Bhagavatam, that this is a mobile deity with us. So this is the Bhagavatam. So as I said, like there are 12 cantos and we have to see the Lord through our ears. And what is said in the Bhagavatam? So there are 10 topics which talks about 10 topics which are very important in the Bhagavatam. So we will see what are these 10 topics one by one. So Bhagavatam second canto says atra sargo visargascha sthanam poshanam uttaya manavantaris anukata nirodho muktir ashraya. So these are 10 words. Sarga means the primary creation. So the Bhagavatam 12 cantos explain about the creation of this whole universe, how Krishna created this whole universe. So you might have understand, like, okay, here is the Goloka Vrindavan. From there, Krishna expanded as Shankarshan and Balaramji. And then from there, Mahavishnu, Shirodakshaya Vishnu, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. And then comes the planetary systems. So the first thing is about the Sarga. So the primary creation of the Lord. Visarga, the secondary creation of the Lord. So which Lord Brahma. So we are in the secondary creation. We are in a place, this Germany, this Holstein, is in a place which is created by the Brahma in the secondary creation. So, third one is sthanam, the planetary system, positioning of the... So, when this is created, then all the living entities have been given places. So that is Dhyana. Utaya, the creative impetus, the inclination to do auspicious. So now I am already entered into this world. So then I need to have the impetus to do good or bad. So for example, not everyone of us taken a decision on a Saturday weekend to go to temple rather than going to a theater. So we have made a decision. According to the psychologist, it is said that a person in a day makes 30,000 decisions. It's a study given by the psychologist. We make 30,000 decisions a day. So without knowing, we are making so many decisions. So the decision of to wear this particular shirt was made by you. The decision to go was made by you. The decision to eat was made by you. So we are taking so many decisions in our life, but we are not even conscious of the decisions. So once we become conscious of our decisions, our life can, we can set our life in a right path. So that's why it is very important that whatever we do, we are conscious of that doing. So that's why this movement is also called Krishna consciousness. So that means you have to be conscious first, then you can become Krishna conscious. So it is very important that how we become conscious of these things. So we have to be really careful, like, oh, I'm dealing with the DD. It's not just a book. Because after some time, even if you have this book, after some months, you just keep the book without even knowing that, oh, this is a DT. Because the mind is always taking this contemplation like, oh, I have been seeing this for so many years. So we are not being conscious. So it is very important that we be conscious of whatever we are doing. So that is very important. And Manamantara. So then, once I am there in this universe and I have the impetus to do, then there should be a time. So when we are doing, how we are doing and all that. Then, in that Manuvandara, then I need to know who is God. Anupata, the science of God, topics related to God and His devotees. So this is given in the 9th canto and in the Nirodha. So, okay, now I have come to this world. So then, somebody should tell me how to go back to my original place, that is the Vaikuntha. So we are all living entities originally from the Vaikuntha. Because of three mistakes, we have come to this place. So now, you are in this place, somebody should tell me. So the Bhagavatam is already telling how to go back to Godhead. Because, why? This is Mrityuloka. So that means, when we are born, on the same day, we are sure as everything, we are going to leave this body. We are going to die one day. If not today, tomorrow. If not tomorrow, day after tomorrow. So the death is the most certain thing to happen in our life. So that's why this place is called Mrityuloka. And the Vaikuntha is called Satchidananda. Satchit Ananda. So a person who goes back to the Vaikuntha, he will have eternal lifetime, eternal happiness and eternal knowledge, full of knowledge. So do we need to go back to that place? Is it a requirement? Or do we want to make our friendships, our relationships here, and at one fine day we leave this body without doing anything? So this knowledge is also given. So all this is really very important topics what Srimad Bhagavatam is giving us. So that's why Sanatana Goswami said that if we want luck and wealth, please read Srimad Bhagavatam. So that's why when somebody says, I will give you the PIN number now and I will give you a prepaid card, and as soon as you finish this class, go to the ATM, draw your half a million. And I am going to repeat only the PIN number once. How attentive we will be. Why? Because if we are not attentive, this half a million is gone. And PIN number will not be repeated. It's said only once. Then we will be ready with our pens, mobile phones, recorders. So we will be ready, eager. Because once if we lose this chance of getting this half a million, and I am going to repeat this PIN number only once, and that too very slowly. So your attention will be like, oh, this number is going to be only once, and he is not going to shout, he is going to say very slow. So similarly, all these treasures, not only half a million, it's half a billion or multi-billion. Things can be reached only by reading Srimad Bhagavatam. So how attentive we should be. So if we are not attentive, it is not the mistake. So there is a nice analogy. There was one barber shop, and in the barber shop that one person is getting shaved, and he was saying, oh, there is no God. The barber said, no. The barber said, there is no God. Then the person who is getting shaved, he said, no, actually there is God, but you should go and get that knowledge, because he has already given everything. No, I don't believe. Then he says, from the window he sees one bearded man. He says to the barber, oh, there are no barbers here. Hey, are you crazy? I'm barber here, sitting here. But I see there are so many people with the beard. He didn't come to my place. He didn't come here for the shaving, so that's why he has the beard. So then it's a similarly, the Lord is there, the knowledge is there, Guru is there, Gurus are there, living Gurus are also there. But if we deny that, oh, Lord is not there, oh, I don't know how to do this, I don't know this, just by donating, I will go back to Godhead. So whose mistake it is? Our mistake, right? So always our mentality is to blame others. If something goes wrong, immediately, oh, why does the God give corona to us? Same question, many people are asking. Why? Oh, even new devotees are suffering, right? No, we are not suffering. We had lot of classes, online classes. Of course we are also suffering, but we have an understanding. So there is another analogy, how to understand. So you might have already traveled, everyone traveled in the airplanes, right? So imagine you are in Dubai, you are seeing from the airplane Burj Khalifa. So it looks like, if you are standing in front of Burj Khalifa, then you have to look like this, because that is the tallest building. So you have to like, still you cannot see. But you are flying in the air, and you see the Burj Khalifa, it becomes small. So does the Burj Khalifa becoming small? No, right? As an adult, we know that. Burj Khalifa is the same size. But my daughter was telling, oh, Papa, see, Burj Khalifa is becoming very small. Then I said, no, it is not becoming small. We are going very high. So when we see our problems from a high, the problems look smaller. When we see problem eye to eye, then it looks very big. So that's why whenever the problem comes, our consciousness, we have to elevate so high that automatically that problem looks small. If we don't elevate our consciousness high, then be assured the rest of our life we are going to fight with the problems. We will never be happy. We will always be complaining. There will be corona. There will be a second corona. There will be a third corona in our lives. Because we are seeing the problem at a ground level. So we have to elevate our consciousness high. So that elevation will come through reading the Shastras, hearing the Bhagavatam, chanting the holy name. So, this, Mataji, till what time is
it?
Till what time?
I don't remember what time we started, but you have at least 15 minutes, at least more, 20 minutes or so.
Okay, then. Yeah.
Who is your Guru Maharaj?
His name is Radhanath Swami.
Sorry, I forgot. I just wanted to say, because I was thinking of Bhakti Bhushanath Swami. He was here one time, and he asked the same question. So we told him, you know, 1 hour in question. Then 1 hour was passed, everybody was listening. And he said, we should stop now. I asked the devotees, shall we stop? No, we continue. So we continue. Okay, half an hour more. 4 hours he was sitting there talking and everybody was listening. So, but now you have 20 minutes. Don't be afraid.
So this elevation of our consciousness, so this is more important. So that's why in the process of bhakti, this is really like, this is not just, the Krishna conscious philosophy is just not like, I go to the temple, pay obeisances, eat some prasad and go home. It's not like that. The process is working with us. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Chetu Dharpana Marjanam. So that means the cleansing of heart is happening. So I'll tell you one more story. There was one old man and he had a grandson. He said, okay, they used to live on the top of the hill. And he said, okay, there is a lake flowing. Take this bucket and fetch the water. And this young boy took the buckets and he went down, fetched the water, and he's coming back. By the time he comes to the top of the hill, there is only little water left. Why? Because there was some leakage in the water. And he said, oh, grandpa, it's leaking. He said, no worries, just go, get once again. So he goes again, once again, he fetches the water once again. Like that three or four times, and the young boy says, grandpa, you are too old, you don't understand that I'm fetching the water again and again, but it is not really enough water here. Then the grandfather says, my dear grandson, when you first took this bucket, did you notice anything? This were dark. This were dirty. This were dirty. And when you fetched the water four times, can you see this now? The dirt is gone. Although it is leaking. So we are all leaking buckets. At least I am leaking bucket. I don't know about everyone, Mataji. I really don't know.
We all are.
So I am a leaking bucket. So what is happening with the cleansing? At least when I am bringing the leaking bucket on the way, on the path, at least it is watering the flowers. So although we are leaking buckets, although I am a leaking bucket, still there is a cleansing happening. So when we read Srimad Bhagavatam or Bhagavad Gita or when we chant, although we don't see physically what is happening, is there any change? No, there is a change. So here, whoever is practicing Krishna consciousness for a couple of years, even for a year, you can tell that is there any change in your life before Krishna consciousness, after Krishna consciousness. Even for a year. So there was, I think, Tamal Krishna Goswami Maharaj, one of our stalwarts teachers. He was in Indonesia and somebody challenged, like, oh, we are Hindus, we have been doing all the pujas and everything. Then Maharaj said, just give me 6 months and chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra for 16 rounds a day and just do it for six months. All the people might be 30, 35, 40 years of your life you have already led. Just give the 6 months and chant Hare Krishna and come back after 6 months, we will speak. Is there any change in your life? And of course, after 6 months, they met again and everybody said, like, Maharaj, there is a change. So that's why whenever we get any knowledge, for example, now, I don't want to talk about prasadam because
it's not offered yet.
Yeah, not offered yet. So let's talk about gulab jamuns. So nice sweet. So I will give you a plate of sweet and tell you, oh, here is the sweet. And you are just gazing that sweet for hours together. Will it make any change? Will you get really the taste? Will you get the happiness? Or will you feel satisfied? No. Or yes. Is there anyone with the yes?
No.
Of course no. Just by gazing the sweet, the delicious sweet, lasagna, pizza, whatever, in whichever country, whatever you feel like, the delicious dishes. If you just gaze, you will not be satisfied. Similarly, this education also, when we just take this home and keep it, so yeah, Bhagavad Gita VZ is. So VZ is, or as it is, I keep it for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, does it happen anyway? Anything? No. So when I take this Bhagavad Gita home, open it, read it, oh, this is a nice point. How do I approach temple? How do I approach education? How do I approach a teacher? What should I do in a life? What should I offer to Krishna? A person who is equilibrium, a person who is sthita-pragna. Sthita-pragna means a person who is not disturbed in the happiness and distress. How does he look like? How does he walk? These all questions are answered here. And these questions are answered 5,000 years ago in a written format, and that is still valid today. Just imagine, any engineers here?
You what?
Engineers. Okay, one engineer. So many of the engineers, this is a typical question as an engineer I ask everyone. So we come from the engineering background, we have Heisenberg constant. So there is a Heisenberg who is a German philosopher, a German scientist, he gave one number as constant. And that constant has been changing continuously. So it has not become a constant anymore, we call it Heisenberg variable. So there are so many things science cannot explain. Like all the mothers sitting here, when they are pregnant, every 4 hours this amniotic fluid in the tummy is changing automatically. Till day, no science, no doctor is able to explain how this amniotic fluid is changing every 4 hours. All the mechanical engineers from the auto engine, when the piston goes in and comes out, what is happening exactly in the cylinder, no mechanical engineer knows this. And we are sitting in a land of cars, famous Germany, and none of the engineers in Germany from Porsche or BMW or Mercedes know how does the cylinder works. So there are certain things which we don't know. So similarly, we have this knowledge here. And if we don't read this knowledge and if we don't implement this knowledge in our life, this is just like taking a delicious food and just gazing it and expecting it to be satiated, to be happy, to be content in our life. No, that will never happen in our life. So let's be assured that will not happen in our life. Then we will be always remain in the problems. So what is constant in this material world is problems. Whether you are a devotee, whether you are a not devotee, whether you are a man, woman, boy, girl, anyone, everyone has problems. So to come out of these problems, we have to elevate our consciousness. And that elevation of the consciousness happens through these books. And those books are given by Srila Prabhupada. Otherwise, all of us would be sitting here, instead of speaking in English or German, we should have had gone to the Sanskrit classes, trying to understand the Sanskrit, learning the Sanskrit, and then understanding this. So our life in Kali Yuga has been made so easy because English is widely spoken language in the whole world, and even we have the German books. So German, Russian, there are 76 languages this Bhagavad Gita is translated into. Swahili, there is one language in the African, it's called Swahili, which are all just symbols. I was so fascinated just to see that. That it looks like flower, triangle, something like that is a language, and in, even in that language, this Bhagavad Gita has been translated. BBT, so the publisher, is the world's largest religious books publisher, even today. So this knowledge is vastly available. It is not that, oh, nobody told me this many years, like, nobody told me like, oh, Bhadra Purnima, I have to do this, otherwise things would have been easy. So yes, I agree, nobody told, but it is there already written. So ISKCON makes everything transparent. Srimad Bhagavatam, 12th canto, 13th chapter, 13th verse, it is there, it is said there, it is there, and these books are there everywhere. So if we have not done that, it is our mistake. So that's why the same example like barber. So if we are not approaching a barber, then I will have a beard. So it is my mistake that I am not going there. So I really congratulate all of you that you have made a great decision out of your 30,000 decision-making abilities today. You have made a great decision that you have come to the temple to celebrate this festival with all of us. Why we have to celebrate a festival with all of us? Why can't I celebrate? There is a question. Why can't we celebrate in our own house? Is that not a celebration? Yeah, of course, that is also a celebration. But it becomes easy among the association of the devotees. So that's why association is very, very important. So once His Holiness Sachinandan Maharaj said very nicely, when you go to a mayor and give a petition, or when you go to some higher authority and give a petition that please do something, then he might do or he might not do. But when 100 people go together and do the same petition, Will you do or not do?
A better chance that he will.
Better chance he will do. Similarly, when we come, so that's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has done very great job. He has said like, he didn't say kirtan, he said sankirtan. So that means we have to do come together and together we chant. So this person, I know him since 8 years. So now he is taller than me. I'm so happy to see him. So now he is chanting so melodiously. He can do at his home also. Why he has to travel all the way from Mainz to here and do it here? He can do it at home. He can do it alone in his bedroom. No, but when we do it together, so when we pray together, we stay together. So it is very, very important principle. Even at home, all the parents, if we pray together along with our children, our bonding within the family will become stronger. So it is said that the people, those who pray together, they stay together. So that's why we call this ISKCON is a family. Prabhupada has created a world, a home, and furnished it with love. There was a beautiful song in one school, Gopal's Garden School. There is a school called Gopal's Garden, and they have this song every day in the morning. So Prabhupada has built a world, a home, and furnished it with love. So he has already furnished. We have to just come. We have to just enter. Nobody asks you, did you pay the application fee, please? Or did you pay the entry fee? Or you are allowed to be here only for 2 hours? You are not allowed to take this? Or for prasadam you need to pay extra? Or for book this you have to do this? Nobody, right?
Yes, we are. Sorry.
But the books, yes.
Sorry. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
So basically the thing is, Prabhupada has created this world. Prabhupada has created this family already. So it is just, we have to enter this family. And with among this family, we will be able to do this Sankirtan very easily. It is also given, analogy is given. When you are standing in a river flow, you don't have to swim. You don't have to put a lot of energy to swim in the same direction. So when we are among so many devotees and chanting together, just Krishna gives a bulk, wholesale blessings. Okay, all the devotees sitting in first stand get these blessings. So a person who is chanting as a main person, a person who is sitting just and being a spectator will also get these things. So it is very important that we elevate. So that's why the importance of Bhagavad Gita is, Bhagavatam is there. So from this class or from this discussion, what I want to request all of you is, all the knowledge to be happy and wealthy and lucky is there in this place. So we have to take these books, first step, and after taking the books, the important step is read that books. After reading that, it is very, very important, implement that in our life. Once we implement in that life, then our consciousness level will increase so high that even the Burj Khalifa will look smaller. So there is no problem which we cannot face. We have given. Lord says, whenever Lord gives the problem, He also gives the solution. So we have to elevate, just we have to see that we have to elevate our consciousness so high so that we do that things. So just before closing, I would like to ask certain things, like there was a real story about how giving is really important. So during the one time, there was in Calcutta in India, it's Radha Govinda temple is there in Calcutta. And in the temple, the temple devotee or the temple president got a call asking that, in my family, there is one lady who is about to leave her body, so that means about to die. Can you please send one photo of the Lord so that we keep in front of her so that she can peacefully leave her body? So then, this temple president went to the temple shop and frantically looked, and temple shop said like, all the photos are sold out because of the recent festival, there is no photo available. So typically in the temples, if it is Harinamadesh, so we will have the deities as Jagannath Baladev Subhadra, because these are the deities. So then they didn't have anything. So immediately he went to his office room, and there he had Radha Shyam Sundar, which is from the Vrindavan. So he had the Radha Shyam Sundar photo, and he said, okay, Radha, if not Radha Govinda, then Radha Shyam Sundar will go. So he took out that photo and gave it to the brahmachari, please pass it on to this lady at this house, and she went. And after some time, that old lady has left her body, and then their family came to the temple after some time, and then they wanted to talk to the temple president, and they said, Prabhuji, we want to talk to you something. They said, yeah, please. So thank you so much that you have sent the photo of Radha Shyam Sundar. Actually, this lady, when she was young, she met your Swami, your Prabhupada, and she was quite a rich lady. And she asked, Swamiji, what can I do for you? Then Srila Prabhupada said, oh, we are in the process of installing the deities. If you want, you can do the donation for the deities. So they have given the donation. That lady immediately agreed and gave the donation. And see the karma, see the things, how the Lord's protection. That she was in Calcutta. Where is Vrindavan? That is in Delhi, near Delhi. Where is she? She is leaving her body in Calcutta. And she has donated the money for Vrindavan Chandra there, Radha Shyam Sundar there. And she got the darshan of Radha Shyam Sundar just before leaving her body. So, what I want to say is, the Lord is eagerly waiting for all of us to come back. Because we are His beloved children. We are His beloved children. He is eagerly waiting when these people will come back. So it is like an examiner, like you have written the exam, you have an exam and you have written something. Oh, you didn't write the correct answer, but still your handwriting is good. I will give you some marks. Oh, you have used 2 color of pens. I will give you some more marks. Okay. Somehow he is trying to pass us out. So somehow he is trying. So that means somehow he sent Srila Prabhupada to rescue all of us. Somehow Mataji is here to run this temple. Somehow the things are happening. That we are such a lazy students. We are going to the examination hall. We are not even returning the paper. We are taking the paper and going home. So how does Krishna will pass us out? Do you know why Jagannath has the biggest eyes? Anybody? What is the significance of Jagannath having a big eyes? There are many significance. Yes.
I mean, I have it, joy and surprise. Surprise.
Joy and surprise. Yeah. That is from the Leela. Yes, bro.
That he can see everything.
That he can see everything. Yes. Anybody?
That he's in ecstasy.
He is in ecstasy. So one of the explanations given by the Shastras is, Lord want to see even the smallest thing what we are doing here. If you come enter the temple room and pay your businesses, not full, just like typical, sometimes in the Indian community it is there, like just we do like this. It's not even a complete paying obeisances, or it's not complete, but just we just superficially, not superficially, but we just do it symbolically. So through his big eyes, he want to see that, oh, look, that deity, that person has paid obeisances. Look, he has raised his hand saying Hari Bol. So he is ready to give us marks. This is not theory. This is exactly like this. This is the explanation given, that Lord wants to keep his eyes wide open to see even the smallest good thing we are doing. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has done one step further. If you know, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was born in Mayapur. In Mayapur, it is considered, even if you sleep there in the night, after eating nice prasadam, you sleep there. What Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is considering that? Hey, look, this person is giving Dandavat Pranam for 8 hours. Really, this is not a joke. In Mayapur, if you sleep also, it is considered as paying dandava. Which Lord will give you more mercy than this? I mean, when I heard this, I thought like, hey, this is like cheating. Eh? I am studying so hard to pass this exam and you are giving someone who is just sleeping there without doing anything, without preparing for the exam, no bothered about the, is not bothered about the exam, he's sleeping there 12 hours and you are considering that he is giving 12 hours. Then the explanation is given to me that imagine just by sleeping, Lord is giving so much mercy. But if you are trying to pass the exam or if you are trying to do something, and definitely he as Paramatma, he knows that I am trying to do, so how much mercy you will get. Then I thought, oh yeah, right. Okay, so I don't want to be a lazy student, I want to be an active student. So that's why he is mercifully doing so much for us. So that's why we have to improve our consciousness in one way. So I will give you one more analogy. One person was drowning in the lake or some ocean. And his consciousness was so miser, he was. The person was trying, giving a hand, and he's saying, give your hand, I will pull you out. Then that person was not giving his hand at all. And he's just shouting, like, give me your hand, I will pull you out. He's not giving his hand. A person who is sitting beside this person who is trying to help, hey, I know this guy, you don't tell him, give your hand, you tell him, take my hand. Then immediately he will give his hand, you can pull him out. So,
he will not give, but he will take.
So, our consciousness is, we are always in a mood of taking. We are not in a mood of giving. So from this lady's example that she donated something in Vrindavan and she got back in Calcutta gives us a clear example that by giving to Krishna, we are bound to get it back in many folds and at the right time. In the right time means when I really required something. When I'm really hungry, you feed me a little dry bread also, I'll be very happy. But if I'm like eating till here, after that you give me the most delicious food also, it's useless for me. So Krishna comes at the right time. So that's why we have to change our consciousness. It is just way of thinking. Do I want to give or do I want to take? So that's why the Shastras explain that whenever we go to the temple, we don't go empty hand. We go give, offer something. So we should not feel that, oh, I am offering to the temple, I am offering to this place. We are not offering to this place. We are not offering to this thing. We are offering for our own selves. We are depositing in the bank that we will withdraw sometime later. And Krishna will give you a withdrawal at the right time, at the right place. So that's why our pocket should be always, heart and pocket should be always open for the spiritual things. So, if somebody is asking you donation, that means they are doing a great favor on you. Actually, it is the other way around. They are doing a great favor on us if somebody is asking me the donation, especially for the spiritual purpose. Because this is going to give me the ultimate benefit. So that's why we should change our consciousness. Instead of taking, we should give. So we should come in giving. So there is one nice workshop. With this last workshop, I will close. I think a lot many stories have happened.
Time is?
2 minutes, I think. Yeah. It's a nice workshop. There was a workshop in a, because like from the corporate world. So they called all the people in the room. So all of you, take one each balloon and write your name. Write your name and then you please all go out. So all these balloons, I have kept it inside here. Now, allow everyone come inside and you have to find your balloon among all these balloons without breaking any of others' balloons. And you have 1 minute time. What is the guarantee or what is the probability, not guarantee, what is the probability that all of the people will find their balloons within 1 minute. Question.
Intuition. Intuition.
No. There's no guarantee that you will, in 1 minute, you're not going to find
it. Not the guarantee, probability. What is the probability that you will find your balloon?
Zero.
I mean, this workshop happened, it was 10 to 20% chances are there that you will find your own balloon. Like that, 10 to 20% of the people in this room will find their own balloons with their names. So that means, these 20 people are happy, and rest 80 are unhappy. So now, there is a small twist. Again, you put all the balloons here with your names, you all go out, now you come in, as soon as you come in, take one balloon, because you know all of each other. So, I know him, he knows me. And he know, I know all of you with name. So, take that balloon and see that balloon. Oh, it is written your name. Just sign it. Don't shout, don't do anything. Just go to that person, give that balloon to him or her. Within 30 seconds, everybody has their own balloons. Is it amazing? The power of giving. Yes?
I said something.
The power of giving is so amazing that there are many advantages of giving. Because once if you give, then you will become detached. Once you become giving, then you will not be greedy anymore. Once if you're giving, you will not be jealous. So the power of giving is so high, so powerful, that it will change our entire life. So let's pray today to Lord Jagannath, because he is seeing with his big eyes whatever we are trying to do, that we get this consciousness that the power of giving should come to us, so that we all become really nice human beings, so that we can practice Krishna consciousness better and one fine day go back to God. Thank you. Thank you. Any questions, remarks, critics?
I have a little story.
Yes, ma'am.
You should give one more lecture for 2 more hours.
So first of all, thank you very much for all your good examples. We can remember them and use them for others, especially the balloon. I think it's a nice story. But I wanted to say just these days first of all, you are also about the example, you know, we've been serving for 50 years and then there comes a birth. Just give to Bhagavatam one time and go back to Ganon. So this is already... But still, this is the pleasure of serving Krishna. So it's not for any particular result, but just for the pleasure of serving the Lord. And but then you were talking about taking the book and putting it on the shelf. Yes, of course, these books are made for reading, definitely. And this is a good example. Still, one thing you said, the book is useless in the shelf, but it's even these books, even if they sit in the shelf, they are not useless, even then. Because this story, there is a person who's been regularly giving donations to ISKCON. So I had the idea now that Bhadra Purnima, maybe I'll ask him to gift him with a Bhagavatam, so maybe I have a chance to go back to God. So I called him and said, do you have a Bhagavatam? He said, no, unfortunately, even though I know Krishna consciousness for so many years, I don't have one. So I told him, well, you know, I want to gift you one. I want to give you a Bhagavatam set because this is a special time. So I was, and then it was completely quiet on the other side. And I thought, my God, what happened? And then after a few seconds, he showed me that he was crying because he was very
became very emotional and thankful for the idea that he's going to be gifted with a Bhagavatam set. So, and then he said to me, you know, this is like 40 years ago. I got Bhagavad Gita book and I put it in the shelf. He didn't read it, put it in the shelf. And it sat there in the shelf for 20 years. After 20 years, he had to move to a new home. So he put all his bookshelf in the boxes and he took Bhagavad Gita. So he opened Bhagavad Gita and he read it. And he said he read the whole Bhagavad Gita in 2 days, everything. And he was thinking, oh my God, how stupid I was. First of all, he didn't want to take the book, but then the devotee forced him to, kind of. And then he said, so stupid I am. This book is sitting 20 years in my shelf and I haven't looked at it. And now I'm reading this and I'm discovering all these things. And he decided to change his life. But at that time, he said already he had made some commitment for the business of his father and to take care of his father, his mother, so he was not free to, he only made some changes, but he was not free to completely change his life. Now he said to me that his father passed away, now the mother is still living. When she passes away, he is going to pack up all his things and he wants to serve Krishna for the rest of his life. So this is what reading the books do to you. But even if you don't read the books in the shelf, they have an effect. Because even though he never looked at it, his life was perfect already because he took the book, maybe he gave a small donation for the book, and the book was in the shelf. What to speak if you read it, of course. Yeah. Thank you for...
Yes, Mataji. Actually, like, I heard that these books are like time bombs.
Yes.
So some, there was also one really nice story, but okay, let's keep this story for the next times.
But this means you're going to come back?
No, I mean, there will be a lot of people.
Next year, same time. It's on the calendar.
Noted. No, because a very, really very nice, interesting story, because he's of younger than me, one devotee in Bologna, Italy. He's a young Italian guy with long hair, coming in the shorts. First time I met him in 2007, so he was like completely new. And his parents bought Chaitanya Charitamrita, and they kept it on some shelf. And this fellow had a breakup with his girlfriend, and he's coming and laying on the sofa, and there was something shining there. And then he took out that book and he started dusting, and then he started reading. In 2007, I saw him with tall Italian, good looking, handsome, with long hair, and next time shaved head with a tilak and the shika. So I said, like, hey, what happened? So he said, like, I have been fooled not to be friends with Krishna so many years, and I was depending on so many other things. But so these books are really time bomb. So my aim is like not to keep this book as it is, but if it is a time bomb for someone, so Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Janma Sartak Kari Karo Paropakar. That means first you make your life successful and then do the things for the others. So that doesn't mean that I am becoming selfish, because if I am not a trained doctor and if I have been sent for a surgery, what are the chances that I will do the surgery good? Very little or 0%. So that's why it is very important that we study, we understand, we realize, then we do the things. So at the same time, it doesn't mean that, okay, so if I am not a well-trained doctor, then I will bring to the well-trained doctor. So she will, she is a doctor, surgeon, she is an MD, so she will do the things. So that I don't have to wait till I become the surgeon. So there are many surgeons in our place, so we bring them to the surgeons. So Yeah, with this, I think we will stop here.
Now the surgeon is asking you to distribute this book.
Yeah. So, those whoever have heard this and felt that this is important in our life, and those who wants to give this as a gift to someone, because it doesn't cost much, 5 to 10 euros.
5 euros.
Yeah. Five euros or 10 euros, the power of giving is high. So this 5 euros is just for the printing cost. It is not a sale here. We are not selling, because this is non-negotiable price. The knowledge what we have here, you cannot give the price for that. So we are just giving the print price. So if you are feeling really encouraged about this, gift it to your friend, this knowledge. Gift it to your neighbor. Gift it to your family. Gift it to your children on their birthdays. So normally what I started doing in my family is, whenever I have some occasion, so I invite someone home, if some friends comes, so just I give them, oh, have this book, keep it. As I said, if he reads, then they will enjoy. If not, their children or their grandchildren will read. So if the book is there, they are not going to throw it in the dustbin. So someone will get benefited. So please, if you are encouraged, please take this. It costs only 5 euros in all different languages, English,